Hey everybody, Graham Balachi here from Building Blocks for Modern Humans. Thanks for joining me once again. So in this video, we're going to be continuing our journey of the different energy sources that modern humans use to fuel their existence. Today's focus will be natural gas, which is the third of the three main fossil fuels. The first was coal, and we looked at that already, and then we had made a video on oil and petroleum. Today will be natural gas. Natural gas is, well, a natural gas. It is a gas that exists out in nature, in the ground, typically in and around the same areas that we find coal and oil and petroleum. And we can pipe it around and burn it for its heat. We can also use it to create different, for different chemical processes as well. And we're going to be introducing those later in this video. So this video is for those people who want to learn about how much natural gas we use, what we use it for, where it comes from, what it is, and some of the downsides to using natural gas. So stay tuned for that. If you're liking this video, it really helped me out if you would like the video on the YouTube button there. And also, if you like this content, please subscribe to this channel and you'll get a notification every time I put out another video. So natural gas, let's get to it. In terms of a little history, similar to the other fossil fuels, humans encountered natural gas thousands of years ago. In fact, there's a legend from ancient Greece at Mount Chimera where natural gas would seep out of the ground and light on fire. And this started the legend of this magical creature called the Chimera that looks like this.
She breathes fire, she's part lion, part goat, and part dragon, and she's totally awesome.
As an actual fuel, natural gas wasn't really used until the 20th century, where we came up with vast pipeline networks to get the natural gas from the source to where it was actually going to be consumed. Prior to that, it all had to be consumed very close to the natural gas well, which limited its use. Nowadays, we use a lot of it. So how much do we use? Let's take a look.
So as per usual, we bust out our trusty 2019 World Total Primary Energy Supply from the IEA, the International Energy Agency. Remember from last time that coal came out at 26.8, oil at 30.9, and at number three, natural gas, comes in at a hefty 23.2% of world total primary energy supply. So that's a lot. That actually works out to 3.94 trillion cubic meters per year. And that is such a crazy volume. Like, think about it this way. Imagine 1 meter stretched out in front of you, and then over to the side, and then up. So take that volume, which is a cubic meter, and make 1,000 of them long, 1,000 of them wide, and 1,000 of them up. That is 1 billion cubic meters per year. To get a trillion, you need 1,000 of those. So that times 4 would be pretty close to this 3.94 trillion cubic meters per year. And the growth in the use of natural gas is pretty crazy as well. This graph shows from 1999 to 2022 that we've almost doubled our consumption from about 2.2 trillion cubic meters per year to over 4 at one point, tailed off a little bit, in and around 4 now. So natural gas is huge for humanity. It's a super valuable resource that we're using a lot more of these days. Taking a look now at the world total final energy consumption, we can see natural gas has dropped from 23.2 down to 16.4%. It's because a lot of this is being turned into electricity. So natural gas supplies about 25%, so one quarter of the global electricity, which is crazy. Again, just to show you that we are using a lot of natural gas and it's producing a lot of important stuff for us, including a good chunk of our electricity.
All right, so humans use a lot of natural gas, but what do we use it for? Well, something you may be really familiar with is cooking. One in three homes in the United States, and I think it's probably similar for most of the developed world, use natural gas for cooking. You can see it right in your stovetop, you can see it in your ovens. The gas that comes out that click, click, click sparks up and then heats up your pot and pans, that's natural gas, and that's just burning, combining with the air in the room and burning and producing heat that we can use in that process. So that's an example of a process application, a process heating application. Another example could be desalination, where quite simply, we use natural gas in parts of the world where there isn't a lot of fresh water, water that's free of salt and other things like that, so we can actually use it for humans to drink. To get rid of the salt, one thing you can do is boil the water, which leaves the salt behind, and then you take all that steam and you condense it back into water that has been desalinated. To boil the water, you need heat, and that could, and you could use natural gas for that. So that's another example of process heating using natural gas. Another big example is space heating, and that's just heating buildings, heating spaces within buildings for humans to be comfortable. This room that I'm in right now in my apartment in Vancouver, BC, Canada, is heated using natural gas, a little bit indirectly. The way that we do it here is we have a boiler downstairs that heats water to a certain temperature, and then we pipe that water throughout the building. And underneath my couch here is a radiator where the hot water goes through a series of tubes and radiates out into the room. So I'm not burning natural gas in this room, but we are in the basement, which is heating water. You can also use natural gas directly in a furnace to heat air and then pump that air around your building. That's called forced air. 42% of space heating worldwide comes from the use of natural gas. So that's another big use for natural gas. Believe it or not, you can also use natural gas to power automobiles, just normal cars. Instead of gasoline being pumped into the gas tank, you can have pressurized natural gas. It takes a little longer to fill because you really have to force in and pressurize that gas, but then it behaves pretty similarly to a gasoline vehicle. Another huge use of natural gas is for the production of electricity. So as opposed to using the thermal energy directly, we can use that thermal energy and convert it to electrical energy that we can send around through wires to all sorts of buildings to power, you know, your cell phones and lights and computers and televisions and whatever else, whatever machinery. The way this is done is using gas turbines, typically. There's other ways to do it, but the most common way would be gas turbines, where you burn the natural gas in something known as a turbine, and that when it burns, it gets really hot, obviously, and that expands all the air really quickly. And if you control that expansion, it can turn a turbine, which is connected to a generator, which generates electricity for humans to use. I saw a stat on Wikipedia that about 25% of the electricity produced worldwide comes from natural gas. So that's a huge use for natural gas as well. There's also chemical uses for natural gas. So as opposed to just burning it for its heat and using the heat, we can put natural gas into a chemical process and produce different chemicals. One of the most common chemical processes for natural gas comes from natural gas reforming, where we produce hydrogen. To give a sneak peek of what's coming later in the video, natural gas is a fossil fuel, so it's a hydrocarbon, hydrogen and carbon. We strip the natural gas in this reforming process for its hydrogen, which can be used in all sorts of different applications. We can burn hydrogen for its heat as well. That's not super common today. Some people think it might be more common in the future. One of the primary demands on hydrogen production, though, is for producing ammonia, which is an ingredient that goes into producing nitrogen fertilizer. So we actually combine, in what's known as the Haber-Bosch process, we combine hydrogen with nitrogen to create ammonia, which is NH3. That ammonia then produces nitrogen-based fertilizers. That is responsible for helping grow a huge amount of food for modern humans. So what's interesting is even if we didn't burn natural gas for its heat, we would probably be very interested, without any other alternative especially, for using natural gas to produce hydrogen so that we can produce fertilizers to grow a huge amount of food for people. That was all part of the Green Revolution in the 60s and 70s that helped us produce a lot more food off of less land. So natural gas, incredibly important for producing fertilizers in a chemical process. So where does natural gas come from? As I alluded to earlier in the video, it comes from similar types of deposits for coal and for petroleum as well. Not exactly the same, but there's a lot of associations between them. Essentially, it's a fossil fuel, just like the other two. So ancient organisms are buried underground, and over millions of years, in the absence of oxygen, subjected to heat and pressure from being buried and the heat from the earth, and that turns the organic matter into hydrocarbons of varying carbon chain lengths. We're gonna go over that in the what is natural gas section. So, just like with oil, there is conventional, old school, easy deposits of natural gas where the stuff just flows out of the ground, and there's unconventional, and there's a lot of unconventional, but we have to work a little harder for it, and it's more recent developments that we've been able to get after the unconventional. So starting with conventional, essentially there's natural gas that's associated with petroleum deposits, that's associated gas, or unassociated or non-associated gas, which is just gas in its own deposit underground. So just like in a fractional distillation column, where we take in petroleum, and we talked about in the last video, we heat it up, and the heavier stuff stays at the bottom, and the lighter and lighter fuels rise to the top. In a petroleum deposit underground, you can have a situation where the heaviest liquid petroleum is underneath, and below the cap rock on top, we have an area where it's natural gas. What's really interesting about this is initially, natural gas wasn't really all that valuable. So they would crack open the oil deposit and let the gas just vent out. They called it venting. That can, we'll talk about in the downsides of natural gas section, that can cause environmental issues. So another way to get rid of it is to just burn it in what's known as flaring. And I remember growing up in Alberta, Canada, and seeing natural gas flares all over the place and not really understanding why we didn't use it. And it wasn't economic to recover. So those are your conventional deposits. Nowadays, we recover a lot of that. Not always, but we do. And that would be known as a conventional deposit, the associated or non-associated. There's also a lot of unconventional deposits, which I'll get into now.
Okay, so this is a really cool graphic from the U.S. Energy Information Administration, the EIA. Not to be confused with the IEA, don't worry about it. So to start off, let's do a quick review of the conventional sources of gas. So this is a conventional non-associated gas deposit. So for whatever reason, this deposit is gas only underneath the seal rock or the cap rock. So you can just drill down and that gas will come flowing right out, especially if it's pressurized. You can have conventional associated gas like we just talked about, where you have an oil deposit and on top you have the lighter fuels. Just like in a fractional distillation column, we get natural gas here. This is a candidate for being vented or flared, but this day and age you might actually recover that. So let's look at the unconventional sources. First up, let's look at coal bed methane. Just like you can have natural gas on top of oil, you can have natural gas or methane. We're going to talk about this more in the what is natural gas section coming up, associated with coal. So you can have natural gas associated with coal up here. Now you can also have a couple different kinds here called tight sand gas or shale gas. They're calling this a gas-rich shale. Really, these things are pretty similar, but they're different. The thing about tight sand gas is this is in a sandstone type rock versus a shale type rock. But really, it's gas that's contained within rocks that need to be broken up to release the gas to be produced at the surface. And the way that this is typically done is with hydraulic fracturing, where we pump down a bunch of high pressure fluids, it's water and a bunch of other chemicals, that crack all these rocks open so that the gas can flow to the surface. So that is both the conventional and unconventional sources of natural gas. This graphic here gives you an idea of the relative amounts of the different types of gas. So at the bottom, we have something I haven't mentioned yet, which is called gas hydrates, which are water molecules that are frozen and have encapsulated natural gas molecules. This, as far as I know, has never been commercially exploited, but apparently there's a whole heck of a lot of it out there. It's just hard to produce, so we haven't bothered yet. After that, we have a whole bunch of shale gas and coal bed methane and tight gas sands. So there's a massive amount of these unconventional gas sources as compared to, which is at the top, the conventional gas sources. So these are the really easy ones to get at the top, but really, the vast majority of the reserves are in the unconventional category. Here's a chart showing natural gas production in Canada by primary resource type. So the yellow stuff on the bottom there is the shale natural gas. So you can see the growth of this over time. And it's actually apparent now that the majority of natural gas production comes from shale gas, an unconventional resource. And that's because there's so freaking much of it. So in terms of the physical location of the natural gas reserves that are proven, here are the top five countries from 1980 to 2013. So it might have changed a little in the past 10 years, but this gives you a good idea. In a league of its own at the top is Russia. They have so much gas in Russia. Followed by Iran and Qatar, and then the USA and Saudi Arabia are sort of tied for each other. So that's where these things are located. Obviously a lot of other countries have natural gas too, but these are the biggest reserves. What you're looking at now is a map of the U.S. interstate and intrastate natural gas pipelines. Intrastate means staying in the state. Interstate means going between states. So this is just the United States. This happens the globe over, but obviously the United States is really well developed, so it's cool to look at what it could be. A lot of the natural gas is originating out of Texas there at the bottom, but it's being distributed throughout the rest of the country. There are other locations where it's being produced as well. So this is how we get natural gas piped around the country from the well location to where it's going to be consumed. When you're going across the ocean, natural gas pipelines become impractical for a variety of reasons. So what's typically happening these days is we cool it down and compress it until it turns into a liquid. It goes from a gaseous phase to a liquid phase, and we can put that in containers and on ships and ship it across the ocean economically. And that is how the United States or Canada might sell natural gas to places like Europe.
So we've learned a lot about natural gas so far, but what is it exactly? What I usually do is look at the elemental breakdown first to look at what different types of elements are there that make it up. But what makes more sense this time is to take a look at which gases are present in natural gas. It's almost entirely one, called methane. But remember that fractional distillation column from the petroleum video? The lightest fuels always get to the top, and natural gas is largely the lightest of the alkanes, of the carbon chains, and it's almost entirely methane. Let's take a look now.
Okay, so here's a typical natural gas composition by compound, or by the different gases that are present. You'll see that it's 97%, so almost entirely methane, which is an alkane-type hydrocarbon, which is just the carbon chains, with only one carbon. It's the smallest one possible. The next biggest with two carbons is ethane, and then with three carbons is propane, then with four carbons is butane. It's so much methane that sometimes people will call natural gas methane. Really, it's a mixture of other gases. Now, there's non-alkane gases present as well. After butane, below that, you'll see carbon dioxide, oxygen, nitrogen, and hydrogen sulfide. Recall from our video on petroleum that sulfur makes petroleum either sour if there's sulfur present or sweet if there's very little sulfur present. Hydrogen sulfide is a gas that contains sulfur, and it's actually a very toxic gas that can make natural gas sometimes dangerous. So there's sour gas that contains some notable amount of hydrogen sulfide, and there's also sweet gas that doesn't. So these are the types of different compounds that will be present. Let's take a look at the elemental composition next. All right, so here's a typical natural gas elemental composition. So these are from the elements of the periodic table. 74% carbon, no surprise, 25% hydrogen, that's why it's a hydrocarbon, and then small amounts from the other trace gases of oxygen, nitrogen, and, you know, there can be hydrogen sulfide present, so I threw in 2% sulfur just for fun to show that this could be a sour gas example. So here's the thing, 74% carbon is actually lower than the amount of carbon that was present for both coal and for oil as well, which is why natural gas, as far as fossil fuels go, actually results in less carbon emitted into the atmosphere as CO2 per unit energy as compared to coal or oil. So the more we shift towards natural gas, the lower our carbon footprint gets, although there is still CO2 being released.
All right, like I always finish these videos, let's take a look at some of the downsides of natural gas. As always, the number one is CO2. Burning natural gas, which is mostly carbon, produces carbon dioxide as one of its emissions, and that might impact human-induced or anthropogenic climate change. That being said, there's a lot more hydrogen relative to the amount of carbon in natural gas, so overall per unit of energy produced, it's actually the lowest amount of carbon released when you burn natural gas compared to any other fossil fuel. So that's one of its semi-advantages. In fact, the United States has lowered their carbon footprint in the electricity sector, and a lot of that's from moving from coal to natural gas. So it can have the effect of reducing emissions, but it's also still producing them. That, and here's the thing, natural gas itself, methane, is actually a much stronger greenhouse gas than it is CO2. So when it leaks, actually, is when it would theoretically have its biggest impact on climate change. And in natural gas production operations, obviously a fair amount of it does leak. So that is also one impact that natural gas use has in the environment, one of the downsides. Additionally, in the unconventional natural gas production, with hydraulic fracturing, pumping a lot of fluids underground, breaking up the rock, can cause some minor seismic events, and it has at times, and it's well under control and well studied, and there's a good track record at this point, but it's not without risk. That's another potential downside. There's also pretty minor ones. If you're cooking with gas inside in a not so ventilated environment, it can produce some indoor air pollution, which can be solved mostly by ventilation. It's not a major issue, but it's one I wanted to point out. Additionally, natural gas used in homes and in other buildings, not so much anymore, but in the past there were occasionally natural gas explosions. If natural gas leaks out and mixes with air in the right quantities, I believe it's 4% to 14% natural gas to air ratio, and there's a spark, it can cause an explosion. This doesn't happen very often. Natural gas now has a scent that they put into it so that we detect it and that we can get out of there or open a window or find the source of the leak. And in general, the valves and the piping is also much better than it used to be, that it just happens incredibly rarely. But that's one of the downsides. Okay, that's the end of this one. Thanks for tuning in. If you like this video, please hit the like button. It really helps with the YouTube algorithm. Additionally, if you like this content, please consider subscribing to the channel. Next up, we're going to be going after our first non-fossil fuel, and that's a very fun one, the nuclear fuel, uranium. So look for that video, and we'll see you then.